moments away to you with a thought I hope you'll see. Can't see where it's wandered to, but I know where it wants to be. I'll wait patiently, though time is moving slow. I have a one vacancy, and I wanted you to know that you're the one designed for me. A distant stranger that I will come near, and all you're out there were meant to be. So keep your head down and make it to me. So sick of this lonely air, it seems such a waste of breath. So much that I need to share, so much to get off my chest. I waited patiently, though time is moving slow. I have a one vacancy, and I wanted you to know that
my love. you. And on the highway of the brave, the winds of change are blowing wild and free. You ain't seen nothing like me yet. I could make you happy, make your dreams come true. Nothing that I wouldn't do. Go to the ends of the earth for you, to make you feel my love.
Thank you. Gives this woman to be married today?
Her mother and I.
Thank you. We're just getting our positioning right, you know. Anyway, I don't think I want to welcome you all, and I know that many of you have travelled quite a distance from across the ocean, from the States, from the south of England. So a warm welcome, and now everything is set, all your preparations, all your plans. I want just to say personally, I have never seen such a stirring entry for a bride as was played today. Nor have I seen such dazzling bridesmaids, and I must say, handsome gentlemen as well, plus a rather handsome looking company. So it's wonderful, the day has arrived, the Lord has blessed us with sunshine. This is unique in Scotland, to have two or three days in a row of clear sunshine, at least this summer. So it's a wonderful setting indeed. So a warm welcome to you all. Could I ask you, not those in the bridal party, but could I ask the congregation if they could be seated now? Thank you. I know it's been quite an undertaking to be able to put all this together and to bring everyone across. And I think half the company are actually from the United States, is that right? Hands up, the folks from the United States, including all the bridal and many have come from the south of England. Where are the south of England folks? Right, lovely. So from wherever you've travelled, we've all come here for this very special and this very happy occasion in which we come to celebrate the marriage of James and Lindsay. Lindsay had this idea a while back. I don't know when it was spawned.
I don't either.
To have the wedding in Scotland, because there's a lot of roots here in Scotland, and you've travelled across to Scotland on many occasions. Your mum hails from the Glasgow area, and we know the apprentices are here in number and are from Scotland. So you decided you wanted to have the wedding here in Scotland. But then you had to work out who was going to be the minister. And in case you think I'm just anyone, I'm actually the cousin of Isabel Curry. And you may get the connection. I'm Curry, she's Curry, we're cousins. So Isabel, as we know, is godmother to Lindsay, and also she is the best friend of Christine. So you get the way this is going. And so, anyway, Isabel asked me if I'd be happy to do it, and I was delighted and honoured to be standing here today and to be able to take you through the wedding ceremony. Also, just as a little aside, it was rather interesting. Christine's very good at researching family history, and we do find that the Currys are actually way back a few generations.
Five,
thank you very much. Five generations connected to the Prentices. So we're actually related. Yes. Anyway, could I also just say, if you just make sure your mobile phones are switched off, that would be helpful. Our own daughter's wedding was last year, and we had the mishap of somebody, like the bride, not having her phone off, and everybody else obeyed. So if you can do your phones off, and it's an unplugged wedding, so no digital media just now to record anything, please. As we can see, it's being officially recorded. But of course, when the service is over, record as much as you like. We've actually come to a very special place, and I know some of you have already toured Scotland. Many of you in the bus, you've toured much of Scotland in the lovely sunny weather in the Highlands. But you've come to a very historic place here in Edinburgh Castle. And you know that just not far away from here, some of you may have seen it already, is St. Margaret's Chapel. This has been a sacred site. You might not think so, a fortress, a place of battle. But inside the centre of that, the godly Queen Margaret set up a chapel nearly 1,000 years ago. And so here we are, not far away from that chapel, and also coming into a sanctuary, a place where God is, where we come to honour and glorify him. You know, it said Jesus Christ is our risen Lord and Saviour. He's the same yesterday, today and forever. And the same God of St. Margaret is the God who's present with us now. And may we ask the Lord Jesus Christ to be here, because God always wants to bless when we love and care about one another and likes to bless marriages. So let us pray. We read in the Bible, God is love, and whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. And so God, our almighty creator and merciful heavenly Father, we thank you for your love for us, shown in Jesus Christ your Son. And we ask that your presence be with us now by your Holy Spirit at this wedding service, in all that we say and do, to the glory of your name, who gave us the very gift of marriage. Amen. And now I'm going to ask my cousin, Isabel Curry, to come. And she's reading a poem which was chosen by Lindsay and James for their wedding day.
I thank you, God, for most this amazing day, for the leaping greenly spirits of trees and a blue true dream of sky, and for everything which is natural, which is infinite, which is yes. I who have died am alive again today, and this is the sun's birthday. This is the birthday of life and of love and wings, and of the gay great happening, illimitably earth. Now the ears of my ears awake, and now the eyes of my eyes are opened.
Thank you, Isabel. And now we're going to worship God by singing a very ancient hymn, which goes way back to the 5th century. And this beautiful hymn by St. Patrick honours the God who created us and wants to be close to us and know him as Father and to be at the centre of our lives. And so let us sing this beautiful ancient hymn that's still popular today, Be Thou My Vision. Let us worship God and let us all stand. We should all have hymn sheets, I think. Do we have all been given hymn sheets?
Be
Let's be seated. Thank you. We've come together in the presence of God today for the marriage of Lindsay Marion Hadden and James McCaskey Wise, to share their joy and to give them our love and our support. Marriage is a gift of God. It is something God created. It's said in the Bible, love comes from God, and is a means of grace in our lives. And in the lifelong union of marriage, we can know the joy God can give, who made us in his image and made us male and female. Jesus said, the Creator made them from the beginning male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be made one with his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Marriage is founded in God's loving nature and his covenant of love with us in Jesus Christ. Husband and wife, when they give themselves to each other in love, reflect in some way the love of Christ and his church. And Christian marriage is an expression of a committed love between husband and wife, who are called to live faithfully together, to love each other with respect, tenderness, and delight. Also, the companionship and comfort of marriage enable the full expression of physical love between husband and wife. And the security of love that is shared by a husband and wife brings blessing to the home and impacts for good those around them and helps shape a society in which human dignity and happiness may flourish and abound. Our Lord Jesus Christ, you know, his first miracle was at a wedding, when he turned water into wine, and he wanted to bless the wedding. They'd never tasted wine like it, and they had it in abundance. And so we come now asking God's presence through his Spirit to bless us this day and to enrich our love and to give us these glorious gifts, his peace and his joy. Let us pray. And let's give a prayer of thanks in our hearts for one another, and James for Lindsay, and Lindsay for James. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we praise you for all the gifts of your love, and especially today we thank you for your gift of marriage. We ask your presence with us now by your Holy Spirit in this wedding service, as Lindsay and James make their promises to one another. We thank you for your guidance in their lives and for the joy they find in each other and for the love and trust that they bring to the happiness of this day. And since we know that without you nothing is strong and nothing is holy, we pray that you will enrich them with your grace as they make their commitment to each other before you today in the covenant of marriage. Grant your joy be in them, and their joy may be full. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, James and Lindsay, would you like to hold hands?
Yes.
And James, would you repeat after me?
Of course.
As I said before, don't say this bit, no. This is my bit. As a seal to the vows you're about to make.
As a seal to the vow.
You have now joined hands, okay. And I now ask you to repeat, okay?
Okay.
There we are. Okay, now, right. Now you have to look into. There we are. I, James McCaskey Wise.
I, James McCaskey Wise.
Now to you, Lindsay Marion Hadden.
Now take you, Lindsay Marion Hadden.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
In the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
And before these witnesses.
And before these witnesses.
I promise to be a loving.
I promise to be a loving.
Faithful and loyal husband to you.
Faithful and loyal husband to you.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
And there, Lindsay. I, Lindsay Marion Hadden.
I, Lindsay Marion Hadden.
Now to you, James McCaskey Wise.
Now take you, James McCaskey Wise.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
In the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
And before these witnesses.
And before these witnesses.
I promise to be a loving.
I promise to be a loving.
Faithful and loyal wife to you.
Faithful and loyal wife to you.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
And now, as a sign of the covenant into which you have entered, these rings are going to be given and received. May it be a sign of the unending love that you have pledged to each other this day. I'm looking at. By this sign, I, James Wise, take you, Lindsay Hadden, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, for as long as we both shall live. By this sign, I, Lindsay Hadden, take you, James Wise, to have and to hold,
from this day forward,
for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish. For as long as we both shall live. And now I could ask you to bring down your left hand, and then if you put your left hand, and I'll put my left hand top of yours. Okay. James and Lindsay, since you have covenanted now together in marriage and have declared your love for each other, before God and before these witnesses, I proclaim you to be husband and wife. And I do so in the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. And those whom God has joined together, no one must ever separate. And now, could I ask you, James, to kiss the bride?
Yes. I love you.
Love you.
Just one last bit to do. We have what we call the blessing. And the blessing is God wants to bless. It's wonderful to be blessed, isn't it? blessed means something good, and God wants to impart something good to those who have committed themselves. And you made your vows so beautifully, and you've committed yourself before God. So if you just turn towards me, I'll put my hand on your head. James and Lindsay, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you. May he pour out the riches of his grace upon you, that you may please him and live together in holy love all the days of your life. Amen. Amen. Can we relax a minute? And now we're going to have a reading from Scripture, and it's 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which is a very, very famous passage in Scripture. It cannot be surpassed as a description of what God love really is, and we know that's what this day is all about. And it's going to be read in from the Scots Bible, and it's going to be read to you by David Prentice. So I could ask David to come forward. Thank you.
Can I speak with the tongue of men and angels, but have nae love in my heart? I am no name better nor dunning breast or ringing cymbal. Can I hear the gift of prophecy, and am acquainted with the sacred mind of God, and ken all things that either man may ken? And can I hae second faith, as can flit the hills for their barracks? Can I hate all that, but have nae love in my heart? I am no. Can I scale all my gifts and grace and honours? Can I give up my body to be burnt to knees? Can I e'en do that, but have nae love in my heart? I am nae in the better road. Love is passionful, love is couthy and kind. Love is nae jealous, nae sprucy, nae bowden with pride. Nae mislaid, nae hame drugged, nae toasty. Love keeps nae nixtick or the wrangs it drees, finds nae pleasure in the ill work o' others, is aye lifted up when truth dings leaves, kens aye to keep a calm suit, is aye sweet to his doot, aye hopes the best, aye buys the worst. Love will ne'er fail, prophecies, they e'en be by thee, tongues, they e'en devolve, knowledge, they e'en be by thee. All our knowledge is hoffling, all our prophecy in this hoffling. But when the perfect is come, the unperfect will be by thee. In my bairn days, I had the speech o' bairn, the mind o' bairn, and the thoughts o' bairn. But now that I am grown man muckle, I am through with all things bairn. Now we were like looking in a mirror and seeing all things afraw, but then he's looking at all things broad in the face. Now I ken all things hofflin's wise. But then I will ken all things as well as God kens me. In small, there is three things that bides for thee: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of the three is love.
Thank you, David. Good for it. It's for me to maybe just share a few words, and I would like to pick up on the reading that we've heard so beautifully in Scots. We'll talk about that in a moment. But I just think that James and Lindsay just said these vows just so earnestly and beautifully. God bless you both. And I can be the first to congratulate them. That's my privilege as a minister. So I congratulate you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Indeed. And James and Lindsay, I believe that your romance began somewhere about 5 years ago.
That's true.
But I was also hearing when I was watching the videos last night that maybe you had a wee crush on James from an earlier age.
It's also true.
But what has happened today, that love has developed and grown to the point that today it changes to that promise, that committed love. And that's what we want to maybe think about just for a moment, of that commitment that you have made to each other today. You know, it's said the covenant of marriage. And a covenant, if you look it up in the dictionary, it's a solemn agreement. Now, solemn doesn't seem very good for marriage, doesn't it? Solemn agreement. But it's a serious and important agreement. These vows express that something has changed because you have made this now commitment to one another. You know, there's an old Frank Sinatra song that goes way back. I looked it up, it was in the mid-1950s when it came out. But love and marriage go together like a horse and carriage. I'm not going to ask you to sing it. But in these words that come from a secular song, there's a lot of truth, isn't it? Because love and marriage hold together. The marriage, it might be a legal document which we're going to sign in a moment, but we know that what binds that marriage together is the love in our hearts for each other. Now, this passage that we read today from Corinthians, I said it can't be surpassed. Because it says something, the first few verses that David read to us. Now, I know that some of us maybe might not have picked up all the Scots, but I'll try and do some translations along the way to help you. But it said something like, but if you hae nae love in my heart, I'm nocht. In other words, if I have not love, I gain nothing. In other words, there's something about love that's very foundational to life. You see, we can have all the success in life. It says there, basically, even for religious people, I can have all the faith to move mountains. But if I have not love in my heart, I've missed the essence. So we can achieve much in life, but not to love. And that can be expressed in so many different ways. But we know something in our hearts is missing if we don't love. And that extends to all kinds of love. Love for friends, love for family, love in all sorts of ways. But there's something in us. Right from childhood, we receive that love. What does a child look for most? They look for cuddles. They look for love. Why? Because the child grows healthy when they receive it. We need love. But we also need to be able to give love. And God has given us this wonderful gift of marriage. And through the gift of marriage, he has given that particular intimate expression of being able to express that depth of love. Isn't God good? For it says in the Bible, God is love. The very essence of our nature is love. So that's the first point I want to. Usually ministers have 3-point sermons, you're getting the drift. That's point one. Love is foundational, and love is foundational for our marriage. It was based on our love for one another, which began all these years ago and has grown and developed. Secondly, what is love? We use this word, but what is love? And Corinthians spells it out for us because it's a very day-to-day thing. And love, to be truly loving, is really quite tough for all of us in whatever station. So it comes, first of all, it says, love is patient. Or in the Scots, love is patient food. Full of patience. In other words, that's quite demanding from day-to-day. Is anyone here impatient? It's quite difficult, isn't it? And it's sometimes the small things, the everyday things that irritate us. But then we can lose our patience. But if we truly love, we make allowances for one another. So we'll seek to try and be patient. Love, and I love this Scots word, is cuthy and kind. That's a good word, cuthy, isn't it? It's cuthy, it's homely, it's kind. There's something very reassuring in love. And therefore it's treating each other well, being thoughtful, especially when one of us may be feeling very fragile and we detect the signs and we say, I need to be really particularly kind today. And then it goes on to the things that love is not. And he gives a whole list of it. It says, love is nain jealous or nain sprosy. Boastful, that means. Or nain bowdent with pride. Now, bowdent is just full of pride, absolutely puffed up with pride. Love's, it's not about self-seeking, it's not, we've changed, you see, we're now two. Before we're one, now we're two, together. Sorry, we're two, now one. reversing the process, two, now one. So therefore we're thinking for our partner. We're thinking, what are they feeling? It's not just about what I'm feeling, but what is my partner feeling? What's my wife feeling? What's my husband feeling today? So we've got to think, not just about what we're feeling, but what also our wife or husband's feeling. The others go without having to say much about it, but it says that it's nain mislaird, which is rude. Nain, I like this word, hamed rocket, in other words, self-seeking. And nain tousty, love is not easily angered. Now that's quite a difficult one as well, isn't it? Just like patience. Do any of us lose our temper sometimes? I do. Quite quickly, especially sometimes if you're tired. And so therefore, but a godlike love, it says in the Bible, God is slow to anger. In other words, we too have to be very careful before we move into these emotions. And then it says, love doesn't keep a record of wrong, or nae nick stick, or the wrangs it drees. Love keeps no record of wrongs. Isn't that a wonderful way of expressing forgiveness? Because sometimes, you know, that's what this life is about, isn't it? We can upset people from time to time. But one of the hardest words in the English language is to say sorry. And in marriage, we need to learn to say sorry to each other and to say, I forgive you. For that brings wonderful healing. It says in the Bible that it should not go down upon, you know, we should not go to bed feeling angry or out of sorts with each other. Then love rejoices with the truth. There's openness, isn't it? You're in this intimate relationship, and now there's an openness and an honesty. And that's where love thrives. And then it ends in these beautiful phrases, I'll say it in English. Love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. And in Scots that say, I bides the worst. In other words, there's a stickability, there's something persevering. Even when life is tough, and life does get tough now and again, I can tell you, things go up and down. Things can happen to us in life that affect and strain at times. It is saying, I will always be there for you. It's James, you being strong for Lindsay when she needs support. And Lindsay, it's you being strong for James when he needs support. And I'd like just to close with a last point, a third point. That's the daily act, how we go about loving on a daily basis. But it finishes saying, love never fails. Love will never fail. Love lasts. God's love is unfailing to us. Isn't that wonderful? No matter how sometimes we can let God down, God's love keeps on going. It's unfailing love. And that unfailing love, it says, is eternal. Love keeps on going and going and going. And that love grows. You see, God is our creator. And being a creator, there's no limit to love. It's not like I've come now to my wedding day and that's all the love I have. But love will keep growing and growing and going. And when we look and we see those who have been married a long time, love keeps on growing and growing and growing through the years. This is the beginning of a wonderful adventure. Love grows. It says we should rather like we look after a plant. I don't know if any of these gardeners here, but to look after a plant, you've got to water it, you've got to feed it, or else the plant will wilt. Well, the same with a marriage. It has to be looked after, tended carefully. And then it blossoms and grows, becomes something beautiful. And all that we hope for, the joy that we look forward to in sharing life together. I would like to close with a poem which was written on a wedding card, and I found it very apt, and I think it sums up all of what was said in the Corinthians passage. A good marriage must be created. In the marriage, the little things are the big things. It has never been too old to hold hands. It is remembering to say, I love you, at least once each day. It is never going to sleep angry. It is having a mutual set of values and common objectives. It is standing together and facing the world. It is forming a circle of love that gathers in the whole family. It is speaking words of appreciation and demonstrating gratitude in thoughtful ways. It is having the capacity to forgive and forget. It is giving to each other an atmosphere in which each can grow. It is a common search for the good and the beautiful. It is not only marrying the right person, it is being the right partner in marriage. May the Lord bless you, James and Lindsay. God bless you. Let us pray for them. It's good to be able to pray for our families, and especially for James and Lindsay, today on their wedding day. Let's have our prayers for them. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the ways that we can express love to others in our lives. And we thank you today for the opportunities of joy and fulfillment that marriage brings. Bless James and Lindsay, who have been joined together in your name. Confirm in them their happiness. Keep them faithful and true to each other and to the loving commitment made this day, with a love that is patient and kind, forgiving and open to one another. And as they grow together in love, may each be to other a companion in joy, a comfort in sorrow, and a strength in need. And may your presence be in their home. Make it be a place of welcome and sharing, of security and peace. Bless their families and their friends who have given them love and friendship throughout their years. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would watch over James and Lindsay, guide them through the years to come, and when mortal life is over, bring them in your mercy through faith in Jesus our Saviour to the joy of that life which has no ending in your everlasting kingdom. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. And now we're going to close our service by singing another beautiful hymn that talks about God's amazing grace, of his amazing love for us. Amazing grace, and it's also done to a Celtic tune, Celtic twist. Amazing grace. Let us all stand.
Amazing grace, amazing grace.
let's remain standing for the benediction, which just simply means the word of well wishing. And so now, may you go in peace and the joy of the Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with James and Lindsay and with each one of you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
And now we come to the signing of the register, and James is going to escort Lindsay round to the signing place. And during that time, as we do this, Ali is going to sing, I don't know exactly the name of it.
It's called When You Say You Love Me.
Say you love me, the world goes still, so still.
I now present to you Mr. and Mrs. James and Lindsay Wise.
As long as the seasons meet to follow their plan, how long will I be with you? As long as the sea is bound to wash upon the sand. You want me to, and longer by far. How long will I hold you? As long as your father told you, as long as you are. How long will I give to you? As long as say, how long will I love you? As long as stars are above you, no longer if I may.
Thank you and good evening. Unaccustomed as I am to speaking in public, I've been asked to say a few words on this most really remarkable occasion. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with weddings in the UK, speeches are a traditional component of the wedding proceedings, and so I'm not just doing this because I enjoy hearing myself speak, although there is that. My first duty is to welcome you here to historic Edinburgh Castle, in this, the capital city of my adopted nation. When I say historic, you've heard of Mary, Queen of Scots? This was her summer place. And her son, King James, yes, that King James, the one who commissioned the 1611 translation, English translation of the Bible. He was born in the next room. And there's actually an amazing family connection to this place as well. On both sides of this new family that has been created today, for in 1860, George Lindsay, who was the great-great-great-grandfather of Lindsay Hadden Wise, which sounds very strange to say, was stationed right here in Edinburgh Castle. Some years before that, Thomas McCaskey, the great-great-great-great-grandfather of James McCaskey Wise, my son-in-law, boy, does that sound strange to say, founded a hat manufacturing company and had a retail hat shop literally yards from where we sit this evening on the other side of Castle Rock with a clear and imposing view of Edinburgh Castle. Thomas McCaskey's wife, Elizabeth Taylor McCaskey, continued to operate the shop after her husband's death during the time that George Lindsay was stationed here. And so it is entirely conceivable that the great-great-great-grandfather of the bride bought hats from the great-great-great-great-grandfather, a grandmother, of the groom. But enough of the buying habits of Victorian Scotland. Back to welcoming you. There are many in this room who have come a great long way to be here tonight, most of whom came here with a great deal of difficulty in terms of their travel. And we appreciate that more than any of you can know. And no one has come farther than James's brother, Chris, the best man, who lives on the Pacific island of Guam. And no one appreciates the convenience of our selection of Edinburgh Castle than Ross and Linda Saunderson, who live about 4 miles up the road. But to all of you who have come from near and far, you honor both families by your presence with us tonight. And I'm sure you would have done the very same thing had the wedding been in, for instance, Cleveland or something like that. But you've come here to Edinburgh, and that's what's important. Christine and I are especially happy to have our siblings and some of their families with us tonight. My sister Nancy and her husband Brian have come from Tennessee, and my brother Mike from Jacksonville. Now, this is Nancy and Brian's first trip to Scotland, and actually Brian was a little concerned that here in Scotland he might stand out a little from the crowd and be a little conspicuous because, you know, I mean, I'll just go ahead and say it. He's a string bass player, not a bagpiper. And yet you've been made to feel very welcome here, have you not? Very good, yes. And now Mike has actually been to Scotland before. We brought him here 25 years ago along with our parents. Who came. Now, Mike wore his hair a little differently then, which is to say he wore hair. But it's just such an honor to have all of you who would come from the United States on this special day. Our friends, our family, everyone who's come from so far away. We're especially happy also to have Christine's brother, David, and his entire family here with us. Mostly from the south of England, not entirely. And the reason I say especially happy is because this has given us the chance to meet Grace and Anya, the two newest members of the family. We've seen the rest of them quite a bit in the last few years, actually, so we weren't as excited about that. But we're delighted to have been able to see these two beauties. David and Anne, Fiona and Sofian, whose wedding we attended last summer, and now baby Anya. Emma and Tim, whose wedding Christine and Lindsay attended 2 years before that, and their baby Grace, all came up from the south of England. And the smartest one of the whole family is Andrew, the uncle of these two beautiful babies, who still lives here in Scotland and who actually works here in Edinburgh, although I understand he's not going to be working tomorrow, and perhaps there's a reason for that. But we're glad all of the Prentices, the Alcassams, and the Sims are here tonight. And to all of our friends and our other family members from the U.S. and other parts of England and Scotland, and especially everyone whom I have just offended by not mentioning individually. You've gone to great effort, many of you to great expense, to be here. That's very humbling, and we appreciate it more than you'll ever know. Christine and I have made a number of new friends through Lindsay and James, but none more significant to us than Joanne and Jack. Joanne and Jack, we so appreciate your friendship. And because they only live about 10 minutes from us, if there are grandchildren, I'm just saying if, no pressure, kids, they should be fairly easy to share, won't they? Which makes them sound a little bit like nachos at a Super Bowl party, and that's not what I mean, but I think you know and you get the picture. There's one person among us tonight without whom none of us would be here tonight. I can say that with certainty. And without whom two of you, Lindsay and Alec, pretty much wouldn't be anywhere. Wrap your head around that. And that is Anne Marie Bush. Anne? Anne Marie set Christine and me up on a date more than 29 years ago. 4 months later, at another historic castle about 180 miles north of here, Urquhart Castle, I asked Christine to marry me, and for reasons I have yet to be able to fathom, she said yes. We got married 6 months later, started our family, and the rest, as they say, has been very expensive. Now, by 1987 North Florida standards, Christine and I were a little older than the average when we got married, which is to say we had finished school. And so people immediately began asking Christine, so do you plan to have a family? And she would say, yes, yes, all in good time. And people would say, well, you better get your skates on, honey. At your age, they would say, at your age, it could take a while. It took about 10 minutes. James, I'm just saying, she is her mother's daughter. Leave nothing to chance. The very first thing I saw of Lindsay coming into the world was a lock of curly red hair. Little did I know that that curly red hair would be such an issue in the years to come. I mean, look at Lindsay's hair today, now that it has become chemically dependent. You would never know that it was ever a problem. But I'll never forget the first time that we took Lindsay to get her first haircut. We went to a professional hairdresser, someone with industrial strength equipment. And he sat Lindsay in the chair, and the first thing he said, he looked at Christine and said, Mom, how would you like her haircut? And Christine said, oh, keep it pretty full, just a wee trim here and there. Looked at me and said, Dad, how would you like it cut? And I said, get it pretty short, if you would. And he looked at three-year-old Lindsay and said, and dear, how would you like to have it cut? And she looked up at him and she said, straight. I love Lindsay's account of how she and James first came to know, or how she first came to know of James, as written on their wedding website. She says, and I quote, James and Lindsay technically met in 1993 at St. Andrew's Episcopal Day School in Jacksonville, Florida. Lindsay had a huge crush on James, who was in the second grade at the time. Lindsay was only four and looked like Orphan Annie, so naturally the relationship did not take off. It was only when they were both in their 20s that they met again, quite by accident, if you believe in accidents. And here we are tonight. Well, James, it's just as well that there was that little interlude, because that means you missed the entire mullet stage. Or again, perhaps none of us would be here tonight. Another thing that's a little hard to believe, looking at Lindsay today, is that her fashion sense when she was growing up could only accurately be described as bohemian. We never really knew what Lindsay was going to go out of the house wearing, and I can remember more than 100 occasions on which she would try to go out of the house and she would be sent back up the stairs by her mother. She would run up the stairs in a state of high indignation to change into something more suitable, if far less interesting. I'd been told that as the father of a teenage daughter, a very attractive, if perhaps a bit bohemian, teenage daughter, that I could expect a steady succession of young men to show up at our door during Lindsay's teen years. And that didn't really happen so much. There was the odd one or two, and yes, one of them was particularly odd, if I remember, but not all that many. And so when more than 5 years ago, Lindsay started talking about this guy, James, I thought she might be onto something. And then I met him, and I thought, well, there goes that. I distinctly remember the first time we met James. We all, as a family, went out to dinner at that emporium of Caribbean authenticity, Bahama Breeze, in the St. John's Town Center in Jacksonville. Now, keep in mind, Lindsay had always expressed an interest or a preference for tall, wiry, red-headed, fair-skinned, Scottish, or at the very least, Irish-looking guys, which of course describes James to a T. And you know, they, whoever they are, say that women often choose someone who's a lot like their father. Oh yeah, James and I are practically indistinguishable from each other in every way. No. Just so it shows how much they know. So when we first sat down to dinner that night, I took one look at James and I thought, this will be a one and done kind of a thing. And then as dinner progressed, I thought, but I kind of like this guy for Lindsay. So I hope I'm wrong. Then as I saw how James looked at Lindsay and how she looked at him, how they regarded each other, I thought, you know what? There might be something here. And in these 5 years, I've come to know James as one of the hardest working men I've ever known. And so ever since my own father and Christine's father, Jim, in fact, I see a lot of both of those men in you, James. So maybe this thing about a woman going for someone like their father skips a generation every now and then. James, over the course of the last 5 years, I've slowly relinquished my time with Lindsay to you. And now that you're married, I complete that process. But the daddy-daughter days that we've spent, like the one in New York City for Lindsay's 8th birthday, the one in Glasgow about 2 years ago, and just some days we've had here in Edinburgh in the last week, I'm keeping those, buddy. So every now and then, I know you'll understand if I need a Lindsay fix, right?
Of course.
Thank you. Lindsay and James, you have decided to do life together. Not just to live together in the holiest state of matrimony, but to do life together. And having done life with your mother, Lindsay, for more than 28 years now, I feel that I'm somewhat qualified to give you and James a bit of advice on how to do life well together. So remember first that love is a verb. It's an action word. It's more than a feeling. It's something you choose to do, even on those occasions when your spouse is not particularly lovable. Just ask Christine. And as youth gives way to middle age, and as waistlines and hairlines just give way, remember that you married a soul, and that never changes. Practice laughter. If you do have children, there will be even more opportunities to do this. Find things that you can both laugh at, and just delight hilariously in each other's love. Don't worry about whose job it is, whose fault it is, or who gets the credit. Just clean it up. Be quick to forgive. Just ignore each other's shortcomings. Help each other overcome each other's shortcomings, but don't help too much. And James, breakfast in bed regularly, will make it a lot easier for your wife to ignore your shortcomings. I speak from experience. And finally, don't sweat the small stuff. And remember that it's mostly all small stuff. Lindsay and James, you have chosen to do life together. Do life well. Do life for each other. Do life in love. And now a traditional Scottish toast for the future life of James and Lindsay Wise. So if you would all raise your glasses. And with my apologies to my Scottish family and friends, this can only be done with a Scottish accent, which I don't do nearly as well as you, but I will try. May the best you've ever seen be the worst you'll ever see. May the moose ne'er leave your gurnal wi' a teardrop in his ee. May your lum be blithely reekin' till you're auld enough to dee. May ye aye be just as happy as I wish you now to be. To Lindsay and James. Thank you.
First, I want to say thank you all for coming, and that is a tough act to follow, okay? So, I will do my best, but my wife and I, would like to say a huge thank you to all of you. Not only were we coming here to Edinburgh, but for your kindness, generosity, and good wishes since the day we got engaged. Some of you knew that Lindsay, especially, would need a lot of good wishes. I knew that Richard's speech might be a tough act to follow, so I really wanted to be on my toes for this. So I looked all over the internet for advice on how to make a good speech. And the best advice I saw was said, be sincere, be brief, and be seated. So thank you. Just kidding, there's more. Well, especially for those who came a long way, which is pretty much everyone, so whether you flew in from overseas or even more treacherously braved the traffic on the M8, Lindsay and I really appreciate y'all making the trip. Richard and Christine, thank you for organizing, pulling off such an amazing event. Lindsay and I knew that Christine, who's a project manager, and Richard, who goes to destination every several times a month, would be suitable to the challenge, and one you have truly risen to. Sometimes talking about the in-laws can be a little awkward, but not in my case. My mother-in-law, Christine, one of the most capable women I've ever known, sweet and loving along with it, Christine is a great mum. And she welcomed me into the family in a way I would never have imagined, and I appreciate that. Thank you. And Richard, who's reasonably talented too, is not a bad speaker. So he's a really good cook, and he taught me a lot there. So now if I'm getting to be a Jaguars fan, I'll have it all. But what I appreciate most about Christina's Richard and Richard is the way they've raised their daughter. In my opinion, their truly greatest accomplishment. I'm trying to say that without choking up a little bit. And I want to thank my mom and Jack. Mom, you always had faith in me, even when I wasn't necessarily warranted. I'm sure a lot in high school. You've always been there for me, and you're here for me now, and I appreciate that. Jack, thank you for loving Joanne. And yes, I call my mother Joanne, because that is her name. And for sharing your life with her, and thank you for being here today. Many of you know the story by now, and that Lindsay has known me since she was in kindergarten. And I was in the fifth grade, of course. I was way too much of a stud in the fifth grade to notice her. But 17 years later, when we met again, oh, for the first time, if you ask me, I noticed her. Oh, yes, I noticed. There are some who say that I've changed since we've been together. Well, I have. For the better, and it's because of you. You're the most beautiful and amazing person I've ever known, and I'm so proud to be your husband. Yeah. People have asked me how I knew Lindsay was the one. Oh man, this is really easy. One weekend several years ago, Lindsay and I went camping with a bunch of friends. Now, I don't want to say Lindsay has been spoiled in her travel experiences. Miss Virgin Atlantic upper class at age 15. Right. But Lindsay's idea of roughing it is when you have to pay for the Wi-Fi at the Marriott. It was 100 degrees for the British folks in the room. That's 38 in real money. And all of you know Lindsay's not like it over 72 degrees. And 120% humidity. In Central Florida, with a campsite that was infested, with mosquitoes and gnats. For the Scottish people in the room, that would be midges. Right? And the fact that Lindsay managed to endure all of that with such good grace, and she said she actually enjoyed it. I knew she was the one. Yes. Lindsay, you are definitely the best thing that's ever happened to me. I love you. This is the proudest day of my life. And if anybody wonders about my devotion to you, all I have to do is look at what I'm wearing. And Chris, thank you for being my brother. I know you didn't have much of a choice in that. But I was here first. But you know, over the centuries, Edinburgh Castle has been attacked and rampaged, and parts of it has been destroyed. I want everyone to know that Chris had nothing to do with any of that. But he and I did have a lot of fun growing up, which means we got into a lot of trouble together. Thanks, sorry, Mom. Yes. but you're the one who's traveled the farthest by a long shot to get here all the way from Guam. Thanks, buddy, for standing with me on the most important day of my life. Thank you, Chris. So I'd like to close. Like I said, I would like to close, and I'm sure all of you would like me to close as well, by toasting the most beautiful bevy of bridesmaids ever to be assembled. Hey. So we'll have to toast you as a group rather than individually, because we have to be clear out of here by 12:30. So everyone, please raise your glasses and joining me in thanking Lindsay's bridesmaids. Thank you. And one more thing before I sit down. Lindsay and I just wanted you to know that we're expecting.
No, we're not.
Whoa, whoa, whoa! You'd have a good time tonight. What else did you think? And for celebrating with us at Edinburgh Castle. So again, thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Have a good night. No, I got nothing else. I got nothing else.
Yay! Okay, so I thought the first one was a tough act to follow, and then there's that. So you've laughed, and now I'm probably just gonna cry. Oh shit. I didn't even introduce myself. So my name is Maren, for those of you who don't know me. I'm screwed.
You're doing great.
You're doing great.
Yes. You are. Yay!
I've known Lindsay for...
You are fine. Yeah.
For 15 years. We were brought together in the fall of 2001. Actually, this next week, after September 11th, we started a fundraiser together. So obviously, she's a great person from the start. From spending a little time in class in middle school, as we grew, steadily started living at each other's houses. Sorry about that. We bonded over boxed hair dye. Sorry about that, too. Watching Friends on repeat, our shared fascination for the Titanic, which I don't know where that came from, we soon became inseparable. That was the start to a strong base of our friendship, and I can't think of two best friends who spent more time apart, but we've never been inseparable. From both our study abroads, through college, through moving, we've still remained joined at the hip. Space has never applied to us, and no matter what was going on in each other's lives, we knew that we were a phone call, a message, or a plane ride away. And every time we see each other, it's like no time has passed. Ugh, I thought that first part was gonna be okay, and now I'm just gonna be ruined. Being an only child, Lindsay was a sister I never had. I loved it because I had someone to play with my hair, go shopping with, talk about boys. But beyond that, she quickly became my other half. Someone who could hear me out when I was confused. Someone who supported me during the best times and the worst times. And she's been most loving, best friend. As soon as I met James, I knew he was different and exactly what Lindsay needed. He became the steady calm to Lindsay's energy. He made her laugh. He made her a Jaguars fan. And most importantly, he loves her how she should be loved. James, thank you for loving my friend. Lindsay may not remember writing to this in college. She sent me a message after visiting her grandfather. And she said she wanted him to help guide her to the person that she was supposed to spend the rest of her life with. James, I know that man is you. So with all these people here today, family and friends who come from all over the world to celebrate the love that you two have and the commitment you've made here today, we all raise our glass to a lifetime of love and joy to Lindsay and James.
Lindsay and James.
and I at them. We're meant to be, so keep your head down and make it to me.
When you're down and troubled and you need a helping hand, and nothing, oh, nothing is going right, close your eyes and think of me, and soon I will be brighten up even your darkest night. You just call up my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running. Oh yeah, babe, see you again. Spring, summer, or fall, all you got to do is call, and I'll be there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You've got a friend.
Never wanna end what we are, 'cause no one